Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the world. My name is Patricia Mosser. I'm a senior research scholar here at Columbia SEPA and the director of the MPA program in economic policy management. I'm very, very pleased this morning to be joined by two of my colleagues at SEPA, Professor Takatoshi Ito and Professor Guillermo Calvo, to talk about the COVID crisis, economic policy responses, and what's next. We are going to talk about what's happened in the last 15 months a bit and how economic policy has responded around the world, but we're going to focus particularly on risks and upcoming challenges. Last year, nearly the whole world faced a similar set of economic policy challenges all at the same time. And that's actually pretty unusual. It's not typical. But this year we're seeing beginnings of pretty stark differences with respect to the economic policy choices across countries. And of course, in the economic recoveries across countries. In other words, there's a lot of unfinished business and uncertainty, which is what we want to talk about this morning. So here's the plan. We're going to go for about an hour. Each of us will talk for 7 or 8 minutes about experiences in different countries and open up some risks and uncertainties. And then we're going to open it up to all of you for questions. Please send your questions in through the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. And feel free to send in questions as you think of them. There's no need to wait till we're all done. And I will try to sort through them as we go along. I'm going to begin on the substance with a few words about policy responses in general and the US very specifically. And then I'll turn to the question of what's next. So compared to the typical recession or a financial crisis, certainly compared to the global financial crisis, the pandemic shutdowns that were necessary for public health reasons were huge negative shocks, both negative aggregate supply shocks and aggregate demand shocks. But for the last year in many countries to this day, the aggregate demand shock has been much larger and completely dominant. We really haven't seen much of the supply effects. That has been changing. The policy responses to date around the world have focused largely on those aggregate demand shocks. There's been huge easing in monetary policy, massive expansion of central bank lending, and more importantly, equally massive and unprecedented large expansions in fiscal policy. As we all know, large advanced economies, who nearly always are allowed space to do big fiscal policy, had particularly large expansions. But many, many emerging markets embarked on very large fiscal programs, assuming that they had that fiscal space, which many of them did after years of good global growth. And of course, on another piece of good news, we did not have a financial crisis, which we certainly could have had, to be clear. But again, that's a reflection of the fact that both the economy and the financial system were strong going into the pandemic. The economic policies done to date have focused largely on what I call cushion the blow policies, income support, credit support, lending support, rent forbearance, et cetera. Essentially the sorts of policies that governments provide to give a bridge to the other side of a crisis. Fiscal policy has not to date been about productivity enhancement, improving efficiencies, structural change, and so forth to produce more growth in the future. One of the questions of the big questions is about how fiscal policy may need to change. So let me talk about the US specifically for a few minutes. As everyone's well aware, the US expansion in monetary and fiscal policy has been absolutely unprecedented. The fiscal policy packages were more than $5 trillion, somewhere between 15 and 20% of US GDP, by far the biggest fiscal expansion in the United States since the Second World War. And it's worked very imperfectly, but it has worked. The massive monetary policy stimulus, the liquidity programs, swap lines, credit lending, corporate bond buying, all of those things have created a huge balance sheet for the Fed. But the truth is those have largely wound down as the economy has started to recover. Of of course, the Fed is still left with a massively large balance sheet because QE this time was not only about macroeconomic policy and monetary policy, easing financial conditions, but because, of course, the financial turbulence we did have last year focused very much on the US Treasury market, and the Fed bought absolutely massive amounts of US Treasuries to prevent turmoil in that market, which, as we all know, would have been not only bad for the United States, but for many, many financial markets around the world. So even before the vaccine rollout in the United States, the US economy had bounced back faster, frankly, than many had expected. But of course, it's the vaccine rollout in the US that is one of the reasons that the recovery has continued to the present day. So what now? While the US has made a pretty rapid recovery compared to some countries around the world, many countries around the world, not all, to be clear, there are some very significant risks and policy challenges, however. So I want to name four of them. One, has the US actually overdone fiscal policy response? Was there, in particular, was there too much income support cushion the blow for the recovering economy? Are the deficits so large and the debt so high now that the world is going to demand higher interest rates on US treasuries? Now, you know, modern monetary theory is sort of getting a lot of attention. And that may suggest that for countries like the US, there are virtually no limits on how much countries can borrow. But the US actually has the experience that tells you that's just not true. In fact, the US had a distinct problem with deficits, debt, and higher interest rates in the late 1980s. But it is there's no question that it is a risk. Perhaps more importantly, and my second point, is that U.S. policies have been focusing on cushion the blow, but are those now the wrong kind of fiscal policy for long-term recovery? Again, COVID was a supply shock. We haven't seen much of it until recently, but it was a big supply shock, and we are finally beginning to see the impact of that. Disruptions to the global supply chain, there are clearly labor market mismatches, but the structure of the economy has been changed by COVID, at least partly permanently. And there have been sharp increases in prices in the United States and elsewhere in the last couple of months, even though the economy is not back to where anybody would want it to be. Structural changes in the economy, technology, indices, industry size and structure, labor markets have been massively, things that were already happening have been massively accelerated by COVID. Do we have the public infrastructure to facilitate those changes? And what's that mean for fiscal policy? I don't know. We know the Biden administration has in mind a large structural fiscal policy program. The question, I think, is whether the US can afford it or not. Third question, has the US overdone monetary policy given the recent spike in inflation? Now, I have to admit on the surface, I'm a little dubious about this one, since I think the jump in inflation recently in the US, that was to 3%. For a single month, by the way, was really a jump in the level of prices reflecting those supply shocks for certain, rather than actually sustained inflation. But that kind of begs the question about how the Fed's new flexible inflation targeting framework is going to work. It's not been tested yet. Are going to let inflation run above its 2% target, potentially for some time, if their inflation forecasts suggest that uptick is temporary. That's okay, actually. I mean, bluntly, US inflation has been 1.5% for 12 years, rather than at the 2% target. So 3% inflation, in theory, could run for 4 years before the US would catch up to sort of inflation averaging. But what happens if that uptick isn't temporary? Well, then the Fed is going to need to tighten more quickly. It's going to have to stop buying bonds. It will have to raise short-term interest rates and so forth. And if the economy isn't back at that point, that will slow it down and choke off the recovery. So while I don't think it's likely, it's a real risk, and not just for the United States, but for everybody else. Last and not least, the disparity in the pace of economic recovery across countries seems very likely to get wider as the year goes on. What are the right policy responses there? Part of the answer is clearly public health policy. I'm not an expert on that, other than to state the obvious that getting vaccines out as quickly as possible to everybody around the world is important. But on the economic policy front, my concern is that the international institutions are not necessarily structured or financed in a way that is conducive to addressing that problem in the way that it may need to be addressed. I am completely out of time. I am going to stop now. I'll leave those questions and we can come back to them. Right now, I'd like to turn the floor over to my colleague, Professor Takatoshi Ito of Columbia SIPA. Professor Ito.
Good evening from Tokyo, and good morning for those who are in the US. And I am going to talk about the COVID in the economy, but with the emphasis on Japan and Asia. So let me share the screen to show you some of the points and some graphs. And okay, can you see the slides?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So the COVID started in 2020, and until December last year, the whole year last year, Japan and Asian countries had much lower infection rates than US and Europe. And we couldn't really explain why that was the case. And there are several hypotheses, which I'm not going into because I'm not an expert on the virus and so on. But whatever the reasons that Japan and Asia were spared from the most devastating infections and lockdowns. So we had a lot of discussions last year about the trade-off, whether we are going to lock down and put a severe strain on the economy, but try to save the lives, or we loosen up the restrictions of the movements to save the economy, but maybe that leads to more infections and death. But Japan and most of the Asian countries didn't have this trade-off. They have a very soft lockdown. Some countries had a severe lockdown, but they could have the economy going while the infection rates were much more controlled than the United States and European countries. And there was a sort of a stop and go that when there's an infection rate went up, you put the most severe restrictions and wait for the infections to go down. If the infection is low, then you loosen up the restrictions on the economy, but that will increase the infection. So you have this cycle of stop and go in many countries. But again, Japan and Asian countries have less infection rates. Now, economic policies, Trish, Professor Mosa went through the US. The Japan was similar, sorry. Japan was similar, that there was a huge monetary policy stimulus and fiscal policy stimulus. And Japan maintained so-called the yield curve control to fix the long-term 10-year bond rate at 0%. And there's some the range, they allow the fluctuation. But having 10-year bond rates fixed at zero means that the government has the you know, whatever the fiscal policy they want without worrying about the loan rate to go up. So some people call it the monetization. Some people claim this was modern monetary theory. But whatever it is, there is a automatic cooperation between monetary policy and the fiscal policy. And in normal times, in the old textbook, this is bad monetary policy. You lose the independence of the central bank. But under the COVID, once in 50 years crisis situation, this was considered to be a good thing. So real test comes when inflation comes up, even in Japan, and whether when the Bank of Japan wants to tighten, whether that can be done without political pressure. But that test will not come in the next few years in Japan, because inflation rate is so low and stable, maybe too stable. Now, fiscal policy, very similar again in Japan. There were cash transfers, and it was given all residents flat amount in Japan. In the US, there was a income ceiling, and I think that was much better executed in the United States. But in both countries, actually, the savings rate went up. So cash transfer didn't materialize in the consumption going up, because you are restricted on your movement. You couldn't go travel and restaurants. So naturally, the savings rate went up. So the wisdom of this cash transfer should be questioned. Okay, here's a point that I made, that this is a daily infection of US and Japan. Notes that scale of Japan is on the right axis, and US in on the left axis. Japan is now this 1/30th if the level is the same. So basically, Japan and the US had first wave, second wave, and third wave. Up to that point, very similar movement. And I don't understand why it was so parallel. But basically, it was 1/30th, around here, 1/60th of infection in Japan compared to the US. And third wave came down. Now Japan is in the fourth wave, but US is not. And this is, I'm going to explain as the vaccine's effects, okay? So this correlation is broken. This is a balance sheet of the central bank, central banks, three central banks, which Trish was mentioning. Notes that January 2007 is normalized as one. So global financial crisis, there was huge jump in Federal Reserve and ECB, basically flat in Bank of Japan. Bank of Japan was a latecomer. It started QQE in 2013, went up. BOJ balance sheet went up, and sort of overtook the Federal Reserve in 2018. Then sort of tapering in Federal Reserve, but jumped up hugely in 2020. And it is much more than BOJ and ECB. Okay, so this is monetary policy. This is Japan's fiscal policy. And in the fiscal policy, it's much more pronounced that this COVID was countered by huge policy action in Japan. So red line is expenditure. So expenditure in 2020 jumped up more than, almost double from the previous year. most of them are financed by new bond issue, which is the blue bar. So tax revenues were declining, expenditure almost double, and the new bond issues tripled and more. Okay. So 60% of the expenditures were financed by new bond issue, which is I would call, extraordinary. And under the peacetime, this would be a no-no. This looks like a one of the Latin American countries causing, the fiscal expansion, which will lead to inflation. But there's no sign of inflation in Japan. And I'm sure Guillermo will come back to make some comments on this fiscal picture. Okay, vaccines, a game changer in 2021. So US, UK, European countries are much better than Asian countries, especially Japan. Actually, Japan is the bottom, the least among the 38 OECD countries, bottom of the ranking. And the other Asian countries are no better. And vaccines have no trade-off. The more vaccines, the better. So now the US is recovering faster than Japan and Asia. So last year, Japan and Asia looked better than US and European countries because the infections were less. But now they're lagging in the vaccination speed. Yeah, so this is a 38 OECD countries ranking in the vaccination rates. And this is shots per 100 persons. So if one person gets two shots, it counts as two. So there's no surprise, it goes over 100. So Israel, Chile, UK, Hungary, US, those are top five among the OECD. The bottom five are Colombia, South Korea, Australia, New Zealand, Japan. So actually Australia, New Zealand, South Korea, they are the, the model countries how to keep the infection rate low. And now maybe too successful in containing infections that they couldn't get the vaccines fast enough. But now they are struggling, Asian countries struggling, that they cannot open up the borders and open up the society. So Japan is, so this is the comparison between Japan and the US. And this is, Japan is lagged by 4 months. So lagging Japan in 4 months, vaccination curve look very similar. So it's just 4 months late, Japan is catching up. But which means that, US is now, New York is almost back to normal. So Japan will back to normal probably by the end of September or beginning of October, if this curves will follow. But that's too late for Japan, that is hosting Olympic Games and Paralympic Games. So Japan is now facing a very, very difficult question to host the Olympic Games as planned, or I don't know, cancel at the last minute, or have some infections explosion. So public opinion, the public polls, to host Olympic Games, yes, no, they're about 50-50. So it's very contentious issue in Japan right now. So thank you very much. And I end my presentation.
Thank you, Taka. Last and certainly not least, Professor Guillermo Calvo, Columbia CIFA.
Good morning and good afternoon, everybody. I'm very glad to be here with my two colleagues. And this is a very challenging webinar, actually. The question is what the country should do when this situation of pandemics is in the past. And I think at least from the point of view of emerging markets, the struggle is going on. And what I'm gonna do is just to bring up a couple of factors, if you wish, leads me to take that point of view, not very optimistic at present times. So let me go over my presentation. The first point is what I call the Fed vaccine that has been very effective. So in my view, I think most people would agree that in 2008, the Fed and the other global central banks established their credentials as world central banks. We don't have that formally, but it's very clear that the Fed has played a key role in that respect. So what do we see? We see a very, as already mentioned by my colleagues, a large expansion of money supply, really unprecedented. That's something that we have to keep in mind. And probably the fact that that happened without a flare up of big inflation is what making very popular the modern monetary theory that is still going around and that lots of people are taking seriously. I don't agree with that, but in any case, it's a view that maybe we have moved to a different world. I don't think so. But in any case, these two things, prevention of a Great Depression, probably owes to the fact that the Fed and, again, the other global central bank have played such an aggressive role and were able to keep inflation low while apparently helping output recovery. Now, was that big, the increase in money supply? Well, Professor Ito already showed us that there was a very big increase for the US and Japan. And here, all I do with this is quantify it in a way that makes it even more impressive. How is this increase in terms of GDP? Well, in the first place, notice that the increase started to happen at the beginning of the global financial crisis. So this is like a new regime. That's very important to keep in mind. So in this crisis, money in terms of GDP increased by 20%, which is an enormous amount, but it took several years for that to happen and inflation didn't pick up. So actually Europe was struggling to get inflation about 2% and so on. So that's very interesting in itself already, right? Why this happened? I don't want to spend time on the global crisis, but everybody knows that the global crisis was a financial crisis that started by a big blow up of certain assets, safe assets that lost market value. So you can see this as an attempt to offset the financial crisis that gave rise to this. But what's very, very, very surprising is what happens here, because as already mentioned by Professor Moser, this was not a financial crisis, it was a completely different kind of crisis. And the monetary policy, if anything, helped to prevent that. But it's not, was not an issue of assets going deeply down. And very interesting, the increase is 20%. It took several years for that to happen before. And here, actually happened in the first half of the year. So that's quite remarkable. And we didn't have a an explosion of inflation or anything like that, right? Actually, you saw central banks fighting against deflation, and more clearly the case of Japan, right? So that's where we are. And the question is, should we sort of relax because we've seen this before without inflation? That's an open question, right? But it's the first thing that comes to mind. This is different. So maybe this increase in money supply, this monetization of debt, the thing that we had thought we had overcome as a practice of central banks, that happened massively, both in the US and now, as Professor Ito shows us, also in Japan, does not translate in big inflation. That's important to keep in mind, because that's one reason why, I mean, it's not crazy to think that this increase now will not be that sustainable without inflation as this one was, right? That's a very simple observation. I'm not saying with that inflation is just coming, a big inflation is coming. If that were the case, if this was very temporary, then you would have an increase of 20% of prices right in the door, right? Now, I'm not saying that, but we don't know, we know so little about this that you cannot discount it. So that's one point that I think is important for the emerging markets, as I'm going to try to explain. Now, here is the spreads of emerging markets, some kind of spread for Latin America, in this case, corporate yield. And you see that at the beginning of this crisis was a sharp increase, followed very rapidly, and this is amazing, something to keep in mind, because it's due to the power of central banks. I mean, central banks are the star, the superstars of what we see, really. And we should pause and admire and also be concerned of the power they can have. I mean, this is very unusual. This went through the roof. And then because the Fed, particularly the Fed, took this very aggressive expansionary stance, this has collapsed and goes below the levels. So think of this as risk, as seen by the market, below. I mean, it looks like impossible, exactly. And then in the midst of a pandemic. So what happens there? And I'm gonna talk about that in a moment. So this is good news in principle, but again, as with the inflation threat in the US, this is something that we could very well, or some people could very well think that it's also transitory. So, and if it is transitory, maybe this will go back. I mean, nothing much has happened for this to be so different, except for the fact that the US has sort of already used the bazooka. It is expected now that it will try to go back to normal. Tapering, remember tapering? Well, that's the other point that I want to make. Could there be what I call jokingly, of course, a Fed virus now? We had a vaccine, it's the other way around. We had a vaccine first and now maybe there's a virus. What is the virus that people are concerned about? Well, everybody remember the taper tantrum of 2013 when the head of the Fed just mumbled something here in Washington and had a very big impact on emerging markets and capital inflows. That was quickly recovered. But in any case, what's surprising is the power that announcements, communication has these days. So a small error, this was not an error, it was a perfectly natural comment. But now we realize that the central bank has to be extremely careful in what they say, and they are. So I'm not blaming anybody, but this fact, I think is very high in everybody's mind of the possibility that for emerging markets, at least, the situation can change overnight and very quickly, right? So this is behind the alarm bells that you were set off everywhere, especially in emerging markets. As Professor Moser has mentioned, a possible increase in the Fed interest rate could have a negative impact on the US. But the US is very different, keep that in mind. If you were to simplify the world, the US can print dollars and the rest of the world can't. And the dollar is still the king, whether we like it or not, right? 80% or 70% of international reserves are denominated in dollars. Work that comes out of the Fed shows that the dollar is used for trade as a unit of account and so on. So the dominance of the dollar cannot be denied. So the big advantage of the US is that they could monetize, they are throwing something that people want. In emerging markets, the opposite happens. Up to a point happens. And that's interesting too. So let me move now. This I kind of mentioned already. So where are we? There are also potential problems coming from the emerging markets. Here you have M1 over CPI, the real monetary balances measured by M1. That for emerging markets is important for several countries. And you see something extraordinary also happen here. This is unusual. People don't talk about this. And I think in my small value added, if you ask me where you place it, I would place it in this graph. Because if you go back, you will not see such a sharp, look, this is the beginning of 2020. So you see, there was no crisis up to the March here. And then this kept increasing. And by the end, now March 2021, this is, even though there was a slowdown, you see, an increase of 33% of this variable. So that's very unusual. So again, like in the case of the US, you can ask yourself, is this going to be permanent? And in fact, this happened even though inflation didn't flare up due to the pandemics, perhaps, unemployment and so on, whatever. So this is a reflection because these are real monetary value, not just the nominal. It's a reflection of the fact that there was an increase in the demand for money, possibly for precautionary reasons. So this increase in the demand for money in emerging markets may be transitory. And that would mean that there's a possibility of this falling back to where it would have been without this episode. And that's a large number. So that by itself, leaving aside the increase in the interest rate in the US, is a factor. And I think what the possibility, I'm just talking about possibilities because not even probabilities because we know too little. But one can very well picture a situation in your mind where a slight increase in the federal funds rate in the US brings about a run against the domestic currency with a very big impact on the price level there, right? Now, is that a reason to be concerned? And now I'm sort of winding down. Yeah, the problem is that the emerging markets, these are emerging markets, and this is a fiscal balance. These are data, a little bit outdated, but not much from the IMF. Emerging markets in the 2020, the fiscal deficit was around 10% of GDP. And that did not give rise to high inflation either. But the explanation is partly the fact that the demand for money increases because of precautionary reasons. So when people start looking, realizing that there is a light at the end of the tunnel, that maybe we are beginning a recovery period, that demand for money would tend to go down, right? But in addition, in 2021, there is some evidence, the forecast, basically, that in emerging markets, the fiscal deficit will continue being large, and especially Latin America, where the infection rates are very high nowadays, and there are all kinds of social unrest. We're having possibilities of change of regime, big way in Peru, for example, or Colombia, and even in Chile, unbelievably in Chile. I cannot go into detail. So the risks are very serious in that part of the world. And that's my concern, therefore, that that we may be at the cusp of a process, and all of a sudden what looked like everything was kind of fine will turn out to be deeply different. Do we see some flaring up at least of inflation? Well, look at Turkey, Brazil, Mexico. Yes, inflation is going up big way. Compare that with the US, yes, it's large, but certainly here, especially in Turkey, look how much they went up. And all of these countries are kind of related. When there is noise in Turkey, for some reason, it has a contagion effect on other parts of the world, particularly Argentina. But let's forget about Argentina, it's out of the map momentarily. But even this well-behaved economies, you see that with the exception perhaps of Colombia, inflation has been going up. So there's already something, even though we don't have the shock from the north, and now I'm winding down. So what to do? I mean, I hardly dare to give advice, but I think that monetary stability has to be given first priority, and obviously financial stability. And that sounds like it's something very reasonable. But on the other hand, and for these countries that depend so much on the inflation tax, if they go through a crisis because interest rates in the US went up, maintaining monetary stability would be something very, very hard, especially when you put that together with social unrest, which again is something that's happening more and more. It's something we don't understand, actually. We need political scientists, sociologists, but remember that we have serious social unrest in Chile, a very well-behaved from a macro point of view economy prior to the pandemic in Chile and in Colombia. So this it shows that the social unrest is a phenomenon that has been kind of brewing in the background, and it could be dangerous. And I have to finish here. So doing this, I think is necessary, and I would be happy to elaborate more about, but it's very hard act to follow. And here, and again, that this connects with Professor Moser said, the role of international financial institution. I mean, I hope that they're really ready to go forward. They have shown the mettle before. The Fed with currency swaps can help. It's not easy. Not any country would qualify, but it's something that the IMF has been trying. My concern is that sometimes they say half jokingly, the fund doesn't have funds. When you look at the funds that are available, they go in the right direction, but it seems to me they are too small. So those countries are in a shaky situation. They should be aware of that. And in fact, with this I finish, the question was what to do after COVID. I would say what not to do. So be very careful with the macro. If you destabilize that, then emerging markets, please. I hope I'm wrong. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Calvo. So I have a couple of questions from the audience, which we can start with. And then I posed a couple of questions that didn't exactly get answered, so I may repose them to my colleagues here, and I'm happy to have questions from them too. The first one, though, is related to both things that all three of us talked about. The question is specifically about the Fed's balance sheet and Treasury purchases and how much it's grown, and since all three of us talked about that, and sort of the effectiveness of that. I'm going to broaden the question out a little bit. I'm happy to talk about the Fed. And just with the following note is that in response to the global financial crisis, the Fed and a number of advanced economy central banks, either then or a little bit later, in the Bank of Japan's case, it was a few years later, all sat at the zero lower bound of interest rates, finding it difficult to ease monetary policy, and the majority of them used a variety of things, most importantly, asset purchases. And of course, the Bank of Japan, the ECB, and the Fed did it in particularly large size. What's fascinating about COVID is that, and I'll talk for a minute about QE and you know, how effective it is. 25 emerging market economies did QE in COVID. 25. It's an absolutely astonishing number. And when you look at the combination of what Guillermo Calvo just put up about the size of the fiscal deficits, combined with the fact that more than 20 emerging market countries did quantitative easing by purchasing assets. In some cases, they purchased government bonds. In some cases, they purchased riskier assets. There's a variety of ways that it was done. But there's a reason why money supply in emerging markets has gone up, is that frankly, they indeed did what the advanced economy central banks did. The question, and I think the risk here is exactly the one that Professor Calvo pointed out, is the question is how much bigger a risk does that pose to those emerging markets, even those that had the fiscal space and the monetary space to do what they had to do last year? What sort of risk does that put them in the future? Regarding the Fed more specifically, so let me narrow this back down to the Fed, because that's what the question was about. One of the big changes with respect to COVID is that when the Fed did Treasury purchases and agency mortgage-backed security purchases, in the financial crisis, they didn't start it until 2009, meaning the financial crisis part, the bank runs, et cetera, was kind of over at that point. They were done to stimulate economic activity because they couldn't push short-term interest rates any lower. So they were a pure, what I'll call, monetary policy tool to stimulate credit, to ease credit conditions, to help the economy grow faster. When the Fed started QE, and of course they went on a long time, much longer than anyone anticipated. They started in 2009, they didn't finish till 2015. Partly because US inflation stayed low and growth stayed weak. Not least of which because fiscal policy was expanded initially and then actually tightened in the United States after that. Last year was quite different. They started out doing QE when the COVID shock hit, knowing it was going to be a huge aggregate demand shock. They lowered rates to zero. They started buying Treasury and agency mortgage-backed securities. And less than a week into those purchases, there were serious disruptions in U.S. Treasury markets. So the vast majority of that huge jump in U.S. Treasury securities that you see was a jump, and it wasn't purchased. They weren't purchased to directly for monetary policy purposes, but at least indirectly, they were aimed at calming down volatility and turmoil in the U.S. Treasury market. Because the problem was, of course, if you had that sort of volatility, interest rates were going to go up, and that would make the economic situation even worse. The Fed bought more securities in the last 2 weeks of March 2020, than they bought in all of QE3. Huge purchase. So if you like, it was QE for market functioning and financial stability reasons, as opposed to QE for, shall we say, macroeconomic growth reasons. So the size of the Fed's balance sheet is now enormous. it continues to grow somewhat. And I think the question is, what's going to happen next? The one thing we know about QE is that from a macro perspective, it takes a lot of purchases. If you look at the size of the ECB, the Bank of Japan, and the Fed's balance sheet, you know that the quantities needed to actually reduce long-term interest rates are very, very large. And so we've been in unprecedented territories for the large advanced central banks for 10 years or more. And the question is, will that ever reverse itself? I think it can. The Fed actually tapered already. But I think a big open question is how quickly they can not just taper off their purchases, but what happens if they decide to shrink their balance sheets, which of course they tried to do, the Fed at least has tried to do a few years ago. It may be that the large central banks will not be able to shrink their balance sheets very rapidly or very much. They may have to wait for their economies to catch up. All the more reason that we need to get inflation back to targets and need to get decent growth, because otherwise central banks are going to be in the position of having to continue to do this again and again. And it's not the position they want to be in. Indeed, that's one of the motivations behind the Fed's flexible inflation target. So, I'm happy to have comments from everybody else.
May I give a quick answer to your point with things that are so central that I don't want them to be missed? My feeling is that we moved into a world where not only P prices matter for the central bank, but the financial stability matters a lot. We know that. We always thought, the central banks were created to prevent runs as a lender of last resort. But for emerging markets, that was still an issue, but not for advanced economies since the 1930s, really. We never had the need, the real burning need for the central bank to help us avoid a run. But I think we are there to some extent now, because I'm just saying, if you ask me, why do you say that? Because look at the taper tantrum, look at the small scares that we had in March, in September 2019, and in March 2020, by this sharp increase in the rate of return on treasuries. So when I look at that, the picture of emerging markets come to mind, because in emerging market, in many situations, the Fed, the equivalent to the Fed, has to come to help the financial sector that was very invested, for example, in official money, treasury, the equivalent of treasury. So at the end of the day, it was necessary for the Fed, equivalent to the Fed, the central bank, to come to the help of the market. Otherwise, so that tension was always there and made it very difficult to stop inflation. Because once you tried to stop inflation, right away you had this financial problem that could devastate the whole system. I'm not saying that here we are here, but we have seen several of these occasions, and there is already some literature. Actually, Andre Velasco and I are writing a paper on those issues too at this moment. So I have it very high in my mind. So I wonder if you think, Trish, if you agree that now the financial considerations are much higher in the rank of problems that the Fed is discussing these days.
I think they have to be, because they're perfectly well aware that if inflation does get back to target or above target, and they're willing to let it run above target for a while, they made that very clear. I just want to, be super clear about what they're going to do. They're going to let inflation run hot. How long is an open question, but not just a month or two. It's clearly not a month or two, and I'm sure it's not 5 years. So the question is, what between 2 months and 5 years is enough to let inflation run hot, particularly if the labor market is weak? And the problem, of course, with the labor market, and this is where the supply shocks really matter, the problem is that there's going to be some pretty significant mismatches in the labor market between the skills of the people who lost their jobs a year ago and the skills that are going to be needed over the course of the next 2 to 3 years, and what that mismatch is. There's also going to be a problem with infrastructure investment and a whole bunch of other things, which is one of the reasons the Biden administration would like to do this additional fiscal package, but it's not at all clear that's going to happen. So let's suppose for a minute there isn't a huge amount of fiscal stimulus more, and there's not a big bunch of infrastructure changes, but inflation does indeed stay high. That's the bad scenario for financial stability, because it means your underlying growth doesn't continue to improve as much as you would like. Even if the economy keeps growing, it's kind of not enough, you know what I mean? And you have inflation. Perhaps inflation that the Fed has to respond to much more quickly, even in their new framework, than they might have expected. If that happens, then they're going to taper sooner. They may have to raise short-term interest rates sooner than were expected. And we know how that story goes. We know how it goes for credit markets in the United States. We know how it goes for growth in the United States. And we really, really know how it goes for emerging markets. And in that case, not only will the US feel the pain, but the rest of the world may feel even more pain than everybody else. I think that's actually a real risk. I don't think it's the most likely outcome. I think they're right about inflation. And I think the experience in Japan in Europe, inflation has picked up a bit. Japan, it's nowhere. So the question is, are what we're seeing right now, even those jumps in prices in emerging markets, are they just temporary supply shocks? Big adjustments in prices that didn't happen last year because the whole world's economy was too depressed. That's my expectation. If that's not right, then we shall have to see. And that's the scenario that I'm worried about. Guillermo, I have a related question for you from someone in the audience that I want to pass back to you, or actually talk, this could be for you too. Can you give an example of what not to do in terms of next steps in terms of policy?
I have spoken long enough. I want to hear.
Okay, Taka, what should we not do?
I think I hinted a bit that I think the income transfer to the households, I think we had enough of it, and that ends up in the savings and not consumption. So they have already built up enough pent up demands and cash positions. So I think the that is something that what not to do. And also in the fiscal that I think at this point, as Professor Mosa mentioned, that to shift the workers from the sector, that is going to be a stagnant even after the COVID is over, to a sector which will be booming even after the COVID. And how to move those people? Well, first thing is to reduce unemployment benefit and force them to move to better jobs. And second, probably the use of the more infrastructure investment. Including the 5G network, and make transformation, digital transformation, easier. So so what not to do is that to increase unemployment benefit at this point. That's not something we want to see.
Yeah, from the point of view of emerging markets, modern monetary theory has already landed there. And what I showed that inflation, even though that it's rising now, has been very low over this period. And while the supply of money has increased a lot, so it leads to the simple-minded conclusion that money is not a problem and we're not going that way, given the needs, the deep needs, the serious needs in emerging markets. One issue that came up now is very actual. There was an election in Peru this Sunday between two populists. And so there was an interesting discussion organized by Colombia on Peru the other day. And the question arises, Peru has been very, very successful in keeping inflation low for many years. So isn't now the time when really they're going through a very painful period of a flare up of contagion and so on. So why not spending more money in that direction and so on? And of course that makes a perfect sense. But people who say that, unfortunately, I think they are basing their judgment on the wrong model. But I cannot enter into that. But it is very acceptable, that point of view, because they've seen that money does not seem to cause inflation. So that simple correlation leads to that. And that could be very, very dangerous because it's one of the few anchors that the Peruvian economy has at this point. So it's very important to, that's why we could do a big service to society by pointing out that things that should not be done, if possible at all.
So I have one other thing to add to the list of what not to do. And it ranks in the, it's similar to the vein of what both Professor Calvo and Professor Ito have been talking about, is that temporary things you do in an economic crisis that become absolutely poisonous if you carry them on too long. So too much paying people not to work when they can't get a job for a while for a reason that seems clearly temporary is completely standard fiscal policy. Continuing to do it after, even though it's really popular, is not because it skews incentives. I have another one in that category, and that's regulatory forbearance. There has been an enormous amount of regulatory forbearance around the world with respect to financial institutions, both state-owned ones and private sector ones. Moratoriums on interest rate payments, a moratorium on writing down bad loans at banks. I mean, this has been a massive recession. There are some businesses that went out of business. There are some individuals who cannot afford to pay back their debts. Eventually, those things have to be written off. Some of them will recover, some of them will not. One of the hard things about the pandemic a year ago was figuring out what nobody could really knew which businesses and so forth could survive. Well, we're going to find out. And you can't keep up regulatory forbearance too long, because if you do, you wreck your banking system. And if you wreck your banking system, then the possibility of you having a strong economic recovery is pretty bad. So if I were going to pick number two on the list of things that what not to do, it would be to continue regulatory forbearance in the financial system for too long, because that ends up being a financial and an economic risk in the long run. So there are a couple of questions here. And I know we've gone over our time, but for those of you who can stay, we'll do one more of these. We have a couple of questions about, one is specifically about Latin America, and using the most IMF mechanisms of other compared to other regions. But the question then asks, and this is what's interesting, is that what are the other mechanisms? If the international institutions, do their best, but that's not enough. What are the other mechanisms? And the reason I ask that is later on, there's a second question related to this, which is about richer countries lending to poorer countries as an alternative. So what other mechanisms are there out there, particularly for emerging and low-income countries to consider? So if either of you have ideas on that, please go ahead.
I have a comment on the forbearance issue that you raised. Obviously, if I work in terms of a pure conventional general equilibrium model, it makes forbearance makes a lot of sense because you are making some debts which are not cannot be serviced, take them out of the books. So it's a making completing the state contingent market, as probably Arrow and Debre would say. So if we take a model like that, it makes perfect sense to think about forbearance, because the contracts that were signed before the pandemics did not anticipate the pandemics. Those contingencies are not taken into account, are very costly if you don't remove them, blah, blah, blah. The problem is how you implement that. You really have to have a very, straight kind of administration. The government here can be a problem. And corruption, especially in emerging markets, is very common. And we've seen that in practice. So forbearance is an opportunity to help your friends. Just one example is enough. In Argentina, when they had to devalue 400% at one point in the 2000, then there was a lot of forbearance, but not everyone got the same help. And actually in the financial system, there was something called asymmetric pesofication. Not all debts were pesofied at the same rate and so on. So a great opportunity to help your friends. And so that's an issue. How to implement it is fundamental. I know there are more questions, but what was the other question that you raised?
The question about, if not the IMF, well, one question was for you, Guillermo, directly about Latin America using IMF programs, and should they more than other regions, and should they consider other mechanisms? And so my question added onto that was more about the other mechanisms besides, the development agencies and the funds.
Yeah, no, in fact, we don't have a World Bank Central Bank. If the Fed was a World Bank Central Bank, there are many good things that the Fed could do. They tried to do it, and we've seen them in action at the beginning of COVID with some credit lines, emergency credit lines, as you mentioned, but also some innovation to new lines so that to stabilize the reserve currency market and so on. So yes, the Fed could do that, but it is not in the mandate. So they've done it. Currency swaps, I think, is something very powerful that they can implement, but they have to justify it as a policy that it helps. It's a little bit like now, like the vaccines, subsidizing vaccines around the world. Maybe that's easier, will be accepted much more easily than seeing the Fed giving a line of credit very freely to banks around the world so that there is no collapse. That's very hard because the Fed, leaving aside that it's not in the mandate, they don't have the power to intervene the banks there. So I think leaving aside the IMF, we don't have an institution, and creating the institution now would take a lot of time. So we are coming late. I don't see easy options, unfortunately.
So the Asian countries have very different attitude toward the IMF. So after the Asian financial crisis in 1997-98, that Asian countries decided that IMF has wrong prescriptions and make the crisis worse when they go for IMF program. So after that, Asian countries try not to be vulnerable to a foreign capital and attack. So they piled up the foreign reserves. So foreign reserves of the Asian countries went up so sharply that they will be probably, and they call it self-insurance. So that they don't have to rely on IMF forever. So for example, Korea, yes, Korea is experiences a capital outflow whenever the rate goes up in the US. And but Korea piled up the foreign reserves. So the in the case of the global financial crisis in 2008, and again in COVID, they could use the foreign reserves to some extent and buy time and change their macro policies to get back on the exports driven recovery. So, and likewise other countries, and they do not borrow in foreign currency from abroad. So there is a initiative called Asian Bond Initiative, which means that if you ever issue government bonds, issue in domestic currency, and whoever wants to buy domestic currency, government bonds, emerging market, say Indonesia, Thailand, you know, let them come to buy those long bonds because yield is attractive, but issue in domestic currency. So that have worked well, and Asian countries haven't seen those serious crises after that. So, you know, for Asians, they feel that they don't understand why Latin American countries continue to issue US dollar denominated government bonds in international markets. The some you know, the investment banks and international institutions say, well, let's test the water, how investors like your policy. But, you know, then you issue it, and then 5 years later that you become, you know, in crisis because foreigners demand those money back in US dollars. So there's a contrast between Asian emerging market economies and Latin American emerging market economies. Sorry, Guillermo.
No. That's a very interesting point. Let me just say one word. I know that we are out of time, but yeah.
We are out of time, unfortunately. And we have tons of questions we haven't gotten to, just for the record. And I will apologize right now to everybody that we're not going to get to them. Please, Guillermo.
Yeah, he's perfectly right. Thing is, Latin America also tried the case of Brazil, for example. They issue debt in reais, which is the domestic money. Now, what you see there is that when there is a crisis, there's a tendency for the real to devalue, and they're very afraid of that for other reasons. So they intervene, which means at the end of the day, they start by going the right way. But for some reason, and I think it has a lot to do with credibility, lack of political stability that you see in Asian countries, and clearly in the case of Japan, it's not there. So that if they let the exchange rate go all the way, for some reason they get scared and they intervene. Therefore, it is as if they had issued the debt in dollars at the end of the day. So it didn't help much. Now the reason, partly the reason, I mean, why these countries maybe were led into a trap of not saving enough or having enough reserves was a commodity price boom of 2000. So that benefited Latin America a lot. And when the 2008 crisis happened, the shock on Latin America was minimal because they had accumulated reserves given the bonanza period. So they started to run them down. The problem is that politics is, and economics analysis don't go together. So they felt that now they could start spending and everything would be fine. Until now, they find themselves in this corner and so on. So why they end up doing things like that and Asia has been on the right path, I think we need another web seminar or several other web seminars. Yeah. That's a very interesting question.
Almost for sure. Well, thank you both very much. Thank all of you for joining us. I'm very sorry we didn't get to everybody's questions. Maybe we could save the questions and see if we can get back to a few of you with short answers, because there's quite a few of them in there. This has been, I hesitate to say enjoyable when one is talking about an economic crisis and pointing out future risks, but I hope you found it interesting. We're very happy that you could be here this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Trish.